so excited to be back in Ocho Rios. I first came here in 1989, 26 years ago. Today on the Taste of History, we'll be making a ceviche with a beautiful snapper. We'll make a brown stew, pork, and curry chocho. And for finale, a sweet potato pond. I promise you a very exciting Taste of History from Ocho Rios, Jamaica. There must be a million recipes to make a ceviche or a crudo. Today, Glenn Roy is going to show us his recipe utilizing beautiful fresh snappers and products right here from the region of Ocho Rios.
And as he rightfully said 25 years ago, you would not have had this dish in Jamaica. It was never popular. Today we have a beautiful red snapper. We're going to be serving this with some crispy breadfruit chips. To marinate this fish, to cook this fish, we're going to use the bitter orange or civil orange as is known properly in Jamaica. And this is what we're going to use instead of using lime. Well, obviously, first of all, we're going to have to fillet this fish.
Now, if somebody want to make this at home, obviously, you can just buy a nice fillet of fish. I encourage you to make this at home. It's very easy to make, very tasty.
You can always check for bones, make sure mm-hmm. the bones are gone.
People, when they eat the ceviche, don't anticipate any bones. It could be very dangerous.
Very, very dangerous, Walter. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to make some nice...
A nice dice.
...of this beautiful red snapper.
Fresh.
Don't get better than this,
which is actually very important when making any kind of crudo or ceviche. You want to use the best possible product.
Best possible product. Now that our beautiful fresh fish is cut, we're going to go ahead with the bitter orange. And we're going to try to get the juice from that to marinate our fish.
Really hard to come by.
It is.
Heavy used in South American cooking, as you know. Now is a perfect time to add the rum.
21 age, yes.
So add this into it.
Look at that. You can see the fish already start cooking,
sure.
Right, Walter?
Well, absolutely.
That's the potency of the civil orange. You can already taste that. It's cooked. Perfectly cooked already. Look at that.
Unbelievable. But now comes what makes it unique.
Fresh allspice.
In 18th century cooking, I barely have a recipe that doesn't use allspice.
You're absolutely right.
Barely.
I barely ever cook these days without allspice. Yep. Then we're going to get you some onions. We're julienning this up now. So we got our onion in there.
Onion, there comes a little garlic.
Garlic there. So now we're going to go ahead and we're going to reach in for some thyme.
One point of reference, when you buy thyme, if you're not in Jamaica, you got to make sure you're not hothouse thyme. You want dry thyme, because hothouse thyme just looks green. It has no flavor.
Walter, this is the real deal.
Yep.
And you see two different colors, right? The same pepper. Scotch bonnet.
One of the hottest peppers in the world, and you want to be
very careful. Much appreciated because of how flavorful it is, isn't it? We're going to chop some scotch bonnet in there. Please use your gloves if you're home and use a scotch bonnet.
Yeah, too dangerous.
Dangerous. Dangerously hot.
And don't touch anything sensitive like your eyelids. You're going to be in deep trouble.
Very. Look at that. Look at the color.
Perfect. And tomato.
Walter, we're going to reach in there. We're going to take out.
To seed it and just to fillets. You need it also so later when you serve it up, it has that beautiful texture.
Beautiful color.
Yeah.
We're going to go ahead and throw it all over that. You see the color start coming together there, Walter?
Beautiful.
And then, we got a nice bell pepper.
Perfect.
Look at the color. Look at the color. Beautiful. Then we're going to get our cilantro. Add it in there and you smell that. You smell that?
Yeah. Last one before serving, the salt and pepper. Yep. And we can serve it up.
Jeez, Walter, look at that.
Yeah, it's good.
We're going to set this aside and that's going to cook a little bit more and soak up the flavor. Here we have a breadfruit. I like to refer to it as a natural bread. Here we have some sliced breadfruit. It complements the ceviche beautifully.
What's unique about it, the breadfruit has so many different flavors. When you cook it raw, it's completely different as when you roast it, you know?
It is.
Instead of a tortilla chip, a breadfruit chip. Couldn't have done it better myself. It's awesome, huh? Fantastic as always. We would have not got its flavor right, wasn't it, for the fantastic rum. So let's find out how rum is made in Jamaica.
Jamaica's lush tropical interior is the home of legendary Appleton Estate. These 11,000 acres are nestled in a fertile valley surrounded by rolling green hills, a perfect environment for growing superior sugarcane.
The art of winemaking has been handed down to generations.
The age-old recipe starts with the pristine water found on the estate.
This water has been filtered through the limestone hills at our beautiful natural spring. Appleton Estate has a very unique geographic microclimate. The mornings are warm and sunny, but we have daily showers of rain, which makes the soil perfect for growing sugarcane. In days gone by, we used to harvest our sugarcane manually, so we'd have cane cutters in the field.
A lot of hard work.
We would have donkeys and oxen. We operate the mill where they would actually crush the sugarcane to get the cane juice.
The sugarcane liquid is boiled into molasses, and that is where the magic begins. I can taste the rum already. Wow.
The molasses is combined with special yeast culture and the soft spring water found on the estate.
We now have to find a way to concentrate into our final product, which is rum. This is known as distillation. And we use copper pot still, which is the traditional method that has been handed down since the inception of rum making. And this produces a very flavorful style of rum.
Once the rum is distilled, it is transferred to oak barrels to begin the aging process.
The rum interacts with the oak to produce a nice golden color. At this point, we blend the different types of rums of different ages to create the final complexity in our product.
Potpourri of flavors in there.
It is.
It really comes through.
So who would have thought that rum could be so complex?
Spectacular. Frederick, so good to have you here.
Thank you.
You know, when we conceptualize what we're going to cook today, one of the dishes that in every Jamaican household gets served on a Sunday.
Brown stew pork.
Brown stew pork. So take it from there.
Okay, this is a fresh piece of pork leg. So I'm just going to take a couple slices off here.
Now, Chef, you said obviously you serve this here in the resort, but this is a typical Sunday meal.
Sunday meal. And I'm just going to go through and dice this up.
Important is the little fat that gives the flavor, right?
Exactly. Nothing beats the pork fat. So some nice size pieces.
What would you say, inch by an inch or so?
Inch by inch, about that, yes. The skin is very important. There's all a unique flavor there. Some onions. Ginger adds a very unique flavor to our stew. Fine diced ginger right here. So ginger is very popular here in Jamaica. We use it in a lot of our dishes. Grab some onions here and a bit of fresh thyme over here. Again, just chop these fine here. We're gonna go into the pork and I'm gonna marinate the pork. Of course, a bit of fresh thyme I'm gonna add to the one.
So you're gonna mix that under the pork and then let it sit overnight.
Right. Of course, I'm gonna give you some other bit of scotch bonnet.
The scotch bonnet depends how much heat you want
later.
Depends
on how much heat, you know. Some don't like it too spicy. We always cook a scotch bonnet here in Jamaica. Here I have some garlic. And then you just chop that. Everything just rough cut. And then, of course, I'm going to put it all on the pork. All these nice herbs and
so all these flavors gets marinating the pork, and so the flavor escapes and really gets this unique flavor in the end.
Exactly. So here you season with a little bit of salt here. Of course, your black pepper. I'm going to grab here some soy sauce just to help with the marination of the pork.
Flavor and caramelizing,
mm-hmm. Also, I'm just going to put a little bit of browning. Helps with the color of the stew. So I'm just going to dig in and just marinate it a little bit there. Of course, a bit more salt, a little bit more black pepper there. And then I'm just going to add the pork. Wow, you hear that nice sizzling sound there? Great. Hits it, caramelizes it, and it seals all the juice inside there. So, you know, give us a nice flavor. Here's some dry pimento berry here.
Old Spice.
So I'm just gonna crack these pimento seeds, right, just to release the flavor into the dish. And I'm just gonna add it to the stew and its whole form.
Nice flavor comes out of this pot, Chef.
Right, exactly. They always said the wood fire or the coal give the food better flavor.
Oh, no doubt.
The Maroons of Jamaica were escaped slaves who fled Spanish-owned plantations when the British seized control of the island in 1655. They fled to the mountainous interior areas of Jamaica's cockpit country, where the terrain was difficult and it was nearly impossible for their owners to find them. The Maroons sought to establish independent communities where they would be free from Spanish and British rule. Today, Maroons continue to live on lands granted under a treaty signed in 1739, giving them rights to be a self-governing nation inside of Jamaica. A kampong is one of several Maroon villages that still remain today, and their herbal medicinal practices haven't varied since their inception.
My name is Mark Wright, and I'm from a kampong, St. Elizabeth. I am one of the chief herbal doctors that deal with medicinal herbs and tonic. Up until today, we still practice rituals more of things that no one never knew can be eaten or used. And that's why even just around 3 weeks ago, we buried a lady, she was 107, because some of those people live so long from eating the traditional and natural foods.
Mike, fantastic. So good to meet you.
Greetings.
You're going to demystify herbs in Jamaica for me.
Yeah, which have good, great medicinal values. This one you're looking at now, it's called a soursop. And soursop is good for persons who have nervous conditions. And also the bark of it is good for persons suffering from cancer.
I only know soursop as the food. I didn't realize that
it's medicine.
The tree itself is medicine.
Medicine.
And this you just gave me is so powerful.
Basil.
Lemon basil. Unbelievable. Make tea from it. I'll eat it just like that.
Yeah.
Be perfect in my salp in boca.
I'm going to take you to this one, which is called a fever grass.
Mm-hmm. Fever grass, or we call it lemon grass.
Yeah.
And it goes wild all over the island.
If you're suffering from a high fever, we'd make this into some tea, give it a drink real warm, and then you could wrap in a blanket so you'll sweat that fever out.
It smells so good. Yeah. With that, you don't need to buy any cologne.
Great.
So, Mark, that looks to me like a whole bunch of kindling wood for a fireplace.
No, man, you're kidding. These are medicinal roots and herbs to make in medicine and roots tonic. Tonics that are good for certain conditions, mostly for the male who have problem with their immune system. We dry them first, so what we do, we put them in a pot with water for like 3 days, and then we strain it off, and then we bottle it up. This is the 21 mix of the roots tonic, so can we have a sip for the nice day out in the field?
Let me try that. I'm trying to analyze the flavors because I have a very
touchy taste.
And my palate, usually I can tell a lot of things. Here, I can tell nothing.
It's new to you.
And as you said, it's been around for 270 some odd years.
Yeah.
Mike.
Blessings.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, then we're going to look in on all that flavor. It's smelling fantastic. Okay, we have here some carrots and some potatoes that we're going to add into our brown stew pork.
The aroma that comes out is pot already, and there's it really quick cooking
fabulous,
time.
Fabulous. We're going to go into our curry chocho. All right? Chocho in some part of the world is called
Christophine
or chayote.
Chayote.
But here we call it chocho.
Chocho, which is now readily available everywhere, any supermarket you go to, is a very versatile vegetable because it adapts to many flavors. It doesn't have much flavor on its own.
No, not at all.
But it makes beautiful salad, it makes relishes, and I like it especially when you make it with a little curry.
All right, so I'm just going to open it like that. And we need to get rid of the core, all right, because it's the seed. Yeah? So you get rid of this. Here, that's no good. What I'm going to be doing here is dicing the chocho. It's a nice medium-sized dice.
Again, it's a vegetable that comes to it really quick because it doesn't take any cooking time.
Right, right. You can actually eat it raw.
The chayote or the Christophine is very close in flavor to a jicama. Same idea, the squash, but it lends itself extremely well for salads as well. You don't have to cook it at all.
So, just as I did before, You want to add some onions, some scallions, some country pepper, a little bit of thyme to it. Now, one main ingredient in a curry is coconut milk. All right, coconut here in Jamaica is very popular. Use almost everything here. Dry coconut. All right, we open it and we remove the inner part from the shell. This is a grater here. It's made from a metal. We just use a nail to bore the holes in it, and we fold it, bend it. We use that as a grater. Every Sunday, as a child growing up back home, we used to have to grate the coconut for our grandparents to make the rice and peas, or to cook the stews, or to make the puddings. So here we have a grated coconut. We'll just add some water to this. All right. So water is added, and then I'm just going to use my hands to release all that creamy, milky flavor. And what you do, you just strain it. Pour it through a strainer and you discard the trash. And there you have fantastic coconut milk. I'm going to be cooking the curry chocho. So I'm going to add some oil. Right? And then I'm going to add some curry.
You want to be very careful. Just toast the curry, chest head.
And then I'm going to be adding all the chopped herbs, the scallion, onions, garlic, thyme, ginger. I'm going to add to that there. And next, I'm going to be adding the chocho. So nice yellow color there. My coconut milk.
Coconut milk, salt and pepper, and recipe is done.
Wow.
Beautiful.
It's a nice, creamy, yellow color there. So I'm going to be adding a bit of salt.
Salt and pepper.
Yes.
Nice though. So simple, but so good, huh?
Exactly. So what I'll be doing, I'll just cover and let it simmer. About, 15-20 minutes.
Frederick, fantastic job you did here. It's like stepping back in time.
Back in time.
Did you read here, Taste of History?
Taste of History.
That's truly a Taste of History here.
Excellent.
So you want to play it up and so we can eat?
Of course, all right. Here's a finished product, the brown stew pork.
That's beautiful, yep. See how it nicely cooked all together? It's just gorgeous.
The color is beautiful.
Yep.
Nice golden brown color there.
And also the flavors comes right along with it, you know?
Exactly.
It looks beautiful. The flavors. Yeah, give it up.
Excellent.
Oh, Frederick, you're the man.
Let's try the chocho.
Right now. Oh, sometimes I wish we never gotten away from cooking like that. Fantastic. Everybody now gets orchids everywhere, every supermarket, almost in the gas station they sell orchids.
Right,
in those days, it wasn't this easy. It was treacherous work. Mm-hmm. Lots of money was made, but a lot of lives lost too.
Jamaica's diverse natural habitats provide the ideal growing environment for orchids. In fact, more than 220 species of orchids call Jamaica home.
We take orchids for granted because every supermarket has it. But it was a completely different situation in the 17th and 18th century. Matter of fact, when orchids got discovered in around 1818, an orchid craze started, literally an orchid war.
The first shipments of orchids reached England in 1818 and were quickly discovered by the fashionable and affluent residents of London who wanted the exotic plants to adorn their greenhouses.
It became a very competitive sort of sport for these wealthy men to send collectors out and see who could bring back the most and see who could bring back the biggest. I mean, there are accounts of guys having 10,000 orchids shipped back at one time.
Tropical forests were decimated by collectors who sought out rare or never before seen varieties. An orchid craze swept through the country and ignited a profitable yet dangerous trade.
One of the big characteristics of orchids is that most of them are epiphytic, which means that they dwell in trees. Out in the Caribbean, a lot of these plants have very specific root structures that allow them to adhere to the trees and hold on in the midst of winds and storms and things like that. Even today in orchid collecting on scientific expeditions, a lot of times you have to have someone who's willing to climb 20 or 30 feet up a tree in order to rip that orchid off. There's a lot of danger when you rip them off the tree because a lot of the roots stay behind, which makes the plant weak and vulnerable, making it harder to reestablish in cultivation.
So if you were not able to get the roots with the flower, the orchids wouldn't have a chance to survive. Those roots are so intertwined, and that's why it became such a difficult task to get them off the tree, box them up, and send them over to England.
Orchids were not the only plants to captivate the attention of the English. Fern mania swept through the country as well, and ferns became popular with all the social classes. Mostly, they were imported by botanists from Jamaica or Australia. Fern Gully is the name given to the sylvan, winding road that connects Ocho Rios to the town of Colgate. Almost 300 varieties of ferns thrive in this lush, tropical landscape.
Fern Gully has been written about in many books and featured in several movies. One of the few unexplained rainforests in the world, and there are some ferns that cannot be found anyplace else on Earth.
Until an earthquake in 1907, the Fern Gully Gorge was one of the 8 flowing rivers of the Ocho Rios area. The river disappeared during the earthquake, and the riverbed was turned into a paved road. The dense fern growth appears to have been growing in place since the beginning of time, despite such a recent start.
It's a pleasure to have Tanisha, the executive pastry chef of Sandals Ochi, showing me a recipe called a sweet potato pond, or we would call it pudding. So I know this recipe goes back hundreds of years, even before my time.
Before my time as well.
So why don't you show me your approach to that fantastic dessert?
Here we have some sweet potato here, a traditional grater. So we show you where we start with our sweet potato pudding by gratering it. So we get it nice, small, shredded.
And this you still got to do the old-fashioned way. There's
yes,
no
the
shortcuts, right?
There's no shortcuts.
That's what I thought. You cannot like buy it or ready-made.
No, you won't get this in the supermarket.
Not yet, at least.
Not yet.
Sweet potato is still made in many households, right?
And you'll find a sweet potato in most Jamaican houses on a Sunday after Sunday dinner. You will have this maybe on a Sunday morning for breakfast with a hot cup of chocolate.
Nice. So your recipe calls for coconut milk, and
yes.
I know coconut milk is almost in any recipe in Jamaica,
right.
So obviously no surprise there.
The sweet potato changes the color when you grate it and it sits for a while because the oxidation comes in while it sits there. Now we're going to add some coconut milk here.
That what gets this great flavor later between
yes.
this and your spices and your raisins. That's beautiful. So that's basically the body.
Right. We're going to use the flour for binding agent.
Mm-hmm. All-purpose flour?
All-purpose flour.
You must remember, it's not a stiff dough because it's a pudding. And when,
right.
when it gets cooked, it becomes firm. Perfect.
Then we're going to add sugar for taste.
Mm-hmm.
Nutmeg for flavor.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of our local spices here.
Mm-hmm. Nutmeg, cinnamon.
Some cinnamon as well. Then a little salt for
mm-hmm.
taste.
This recipe calls for vanilla extract. Most people don't realize that the vanilla bean comes actually from an orchid, as you've seen in this episode. Next
I'm
is...
I'm going to add the raisin last.
The raisin. You soak the raisin at all, no?
You can.
In rum?
In rum. Or you can just use it dry as it is.
Mm-hmm.
Traditionally, we will bake our sweet potato pudding in a pot, not a cake pan, because, you know, we're going to put it over our coal fire here. So I'm going to add this mixture to the pot here.
And you want to cook this in relatively low heat, right?
Low
so you don't
heat,
burn the bottom?
Right. So we use a double fire for this.
Mm-hmm.
Here we have our fire under here. We're going to place another piece on top here. So we'll have the hell at the bottom, the hell on top, and the hallelujah in the middle.
Fantastic. Hallelujah.
It's been about an hour. Our ashes has burned down, which is our L on top. Now we're going to remove this cover so you can see actually what it looks like under.
Wow. Fantastic. Look at that. Who needs technology when you can cook like this in the bush?
Right. Definitely.
Unbelievable. So now, next step is we're going to...
And then we're going to cut it. When the pudding is hot, it won't come out as smooth as you'd like it to.
Beautiful. Wow. So simple.
Simple.
So beautiful. And so Jamaica.
Yes.
I'd like to thank the culinary team of Sandals Ochi for bringing you
a taste of history.